Bless the Lord, who forgives all our sins. God's mercy endures forever. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Then God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents, to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor." The word of the Lord.
Psalm 19, you are invited to read along with us, either in unison or responsively by half verse.
The heavens declare the glory of God,
and the firmament shows God's handiwork.
One day tells its tale to another,
and one night imparts knowledge to another.
although they have no words or language,
and their voices are not heard,
their sound has gone out into all lands,
and their message to the ends of the world.
In the deep as God set a pavilion for the sun.
It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course.
It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again.
Nothing is hidden from its burning heat.
And the law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul.
The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent.
The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart.
And the commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever.
The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, more much fine gold.
Sweeter far than honey on the comb.
By them all those is your servant enlightened.
And in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can tell how often they offend?
Cleanse me from my secret fault.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me.
Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight.
O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord. And in the words from our psalm today, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. So here we are about the midpoint in Lent. We are 1 year past. This last Sunday we were in our own building. And we come to this story set in a very sacred space for Jesus, for the disciples, for the Jewish nation. We've come to the story set in the temple. The temple was that place where there was that understanding that the divine and humanity met, that coming together, that meeting spot, where things might get different. Now you got to remember, the story is written down in this gospel long after Jesus has died. This is the latest of the gospels, probably another 50, 60 years after Jesus died. This is written down after the temple is gone. The temple has been destroyed. 46 plus many more years of building, and the Romans have destroyed it. And the people reading this know that. And they know that Jesus has died and has risen and ascended. And so they look back as they are given this gospel, this writing, this story about Jesus. And they know that as Jesus talks about his own body as the sign, there's something brand new. In that connection between the divine and humanity brought forth in the incarnation, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. This is that central message of this gospel. The Word becomes flesh. And it is the place, not just in Jesus's birth and in his life, not just in his cross or in his resurrection, not just in his ascension, but in the totality of that, God is known. And we can come near. And it is not to be a marketplace. There's not to be something that stands between us and this God. Hold that thought, because I'm going to jump back to the Exodus reading right now. The Ten Commandments. We think, okay, so we all sort of had to memorize those or do something with them in confirmation class, or at some point in our development as a Christian, we had to memorize these 10 rules. And in doing that, we've missed the richness and the depth of them. There are rules, the way we approach them too often, that stand between us and God. There are rules that we have to obey in order to have holy lives, in order to get to that point, that connection between God and humanity. But there's something really important in the setting of these Ten Commandments. The beginning of this reading says, God spoke all these words to Moses on Mount Sinai. Moses had led the people out into the wilderness. They have crossed the Red Sea. They have escaped from slavery and from Pharaoh and his armies trying to recapture them. And God speaks these words to Moses here where they have been told to go to worship. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. I am the Lord your God. Not if you keep these commandments, I will be. I am the Lord your God. I have already come close. I've already come down and set you free. And in that context, these become not rules to follow, but a shape of a life to live, a gift of a God who says, I've already visited you with mercy and grace and love and freedom. You don't need other gods. You don't need to make images of other gods, because guess what? You are my image. I've already placed my image upon you. And you, who all you know throughout for so long in your life, it has shaped your families, it has shaped your understanding of the world, it has shaped how you respond to other things. That world of slavery is behind you. So take a break. You are free to rest. And you are so free to rest that you are free to make sure that all of creation rests. Even your animals. And I am your God, and I am already there, and I'm already that, and I gift you with this opportunity to live your lives and honor your ancestors, to honor each other. I am your God, and I offer you this way to shape your life where you can depend on me. And you do not have to worry about what you have, because you will have enough. And you don't need to steal or to lie or to kill or to covet. Because I am your God and I have come close. And look at each other and see me. That image, not in wood or in stone or in gold, but in living flesh. You are the image of the Creator, and I have written my word by your life. Nothing is to come between us and this God, and this is the way God has always worked. And oh, what a shame if our churches become a place where it feels like you have to earn something, or you have to buy something or give something, where it's a marketplace where there's an exchange. Instead, Jesus is that dwelling place where God has come close. And in the ascension and in the sending forth of the church, Jesus says, now you are mine. You are my body. You are the ones I send now to be that and do that, to be that place where freely others may find access to God. And so as we, like those Jewish people who first read the Gospel of John, who were maybe distraught at their temple being taken from them. They could no longer go there to worship. We here have been for a year without our temple, our church, our building. But God is no much farther away from us now than God ever was. And we don't have to step in those doors to find it. Look in the mirror. You bear that image. God, who has freed you to live generously, openly, lovingly, to shape your life in ways that show forth a God who comes to the whole world not just in particular places, and not just through particular rules or liturgies or buildings, but a God who comes to journey with us through whatever wilderness we're in, who comes to walk the dusty roads with us, to eat with us, to teach us, to forgive us, to give life to us. So don't fight so much for a seat at a table that God's coming to overturn anyway. Let us instead go forth, fully recognizing the God who has freed us from the slavery to greed, to consumerism, to fighting for our place, and freed us instead to love, to be generous, to rest, and to work. A God who has freed us and loves us and is among us and is coming to this world through us. Not through our building, but through you, through me. And most importantly, as Christ sent out disciples, through us as community, together. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We give you thanks for the beauty of our world. We give thanks for special holy places and for our own church, and for the holiness we have learned to find in other places during this past year away from our building. We ask you to guide all leaders of worship, to inspire all preachers of the word, to direct your faithful people in the ways of holiness and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all legislators, for those who set standards for us to live by. Guide all those who influence the minds of others. We pray for broadcasters and bloggers, for the press, for political leaders. We pray for all dealing in world trade, in commerce, or industry. Give to each the wisdom and will to use properly what you have given them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for those who have shared with us a sense of wonder or mystery. We pray that we may learn to live simply and be willing to help others to simply live. Lord, protect us, our homes, and loved ones. Be with all who have been made homeless or who feel alone in this world, especially those who have been hardest hit by loneliness during this pandemic. We give thanks for all who celebrate birthdays this week, especially Janet Muir, Marlon Pursley, Lindsay Barrick, and Jennifer Greer. You are invited to name your own Thanksgivings. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who have become possessed by possessions, for all who are captive to greed and covetousness. We remember all who have suffered through the selfishness of others. Be a strength, O Lord, to all who have suffered robbery or violence, for all who have faced the murder of a loved one. We pray for all who have lost their possessions or livelihood, for those who have become overwhelmed with debt. We pray for all who are ill at this time, and for those who care for the sick. And we pray especially for those who have asked for our prayers: Nathan, Amy, Janice, Brian, Jeannie, the Potter family, Steve, Jim, Janice, Linda, Bud, David, Eric, Penny, the Martin family, Paula,
and Ross.
You are invited to name those for whom you pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for all who have faithfully obeyed your will, for all who have worshiped you in the beauty of holiness. We give thanks for those who founded this church. We pray for loved ones departed, especially Mark, Buck Spencer, and Hugh Annis. You are invited to name those who have died. Grant that we may share with them in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Almighty God, creator of all things, we give you thanks for the resources of our world, for the wonders and mysteries of the universe. Lord, help us to use wisely all you have given to us for the benefit of others, for the well-being of the earth, and to the glory of your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we've fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched down his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. So the gifts of God for you, the people of God, I invite you to receive now that which is consecrated here and delivered to your door as we receive as one community together. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace. And grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Bow down before the Lord. Grant, Almighty God, that your people may recognize their weakness and put their whole trust in your strength, so that they may rejoice forever in the protection of your loving providence. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.